and influence of this house.
The mécanique supérieure.
The hopes of the nations of the world on our own soil.
Sejam bem-vindos à Sociedade das Nações, que esta semana vem do Liceu Pedro Nunes, aqui em Lisboa, onde corre o segundo encontro presente no futuro, organizado pela Fundação Francisco Manuel dos Santos. Durante dois dias, oradores internacionais e nacionais tiveram a discutir e a falar sobre a posição de Portugal na Europa e também sobre a posição da Europa no mundo. Dois desses oradores são os nossos convidados esta semana. Professor Menon, welcome to the program. Your paper was entitled, Does NATO Have a Future? What have you concluded? What's the answer?
Well, I've concluded the answer is yes. The sheer depth and breadth of ties between the two sides of the Atlantic mean that some kind of institutional relationship is going to have to persist. The interesting question for me about NATO is, how will it continue to exist? I mean, it could exist as a largely powerless organization whose member states don't agree on what to do with it, or it could have a more ambitious future as a way of enabling Western powers to deal with security threats together. And that's the question we don't know the answer to now.
Ambassador Joao de Almeida, welcome back. It's nice to see you again.
Nice seeing you.
How do you think Syria, this whole episode with Syria, has affected this relationship? Are we further away, America and Europe, than we were before August the 21st?
I don't think so. I think we are closer and closer on the way we see the world and the way we deal with these complex issues. And Syria is maybe the most complex one we have to deal with.
At one point, they talked about NATO being involved, but then that was quickly scotched.
I think the main point is to be very clear about the condemnation of the use of chemical weapons and the call for a political solution. I think we are fully together, the European Union and the United States. It still remains quite a complex situation. We may have time to discuss it a little bit further, but no doubt that we are very much on the same wavelength.
I must say that I'm here with João in a special quality because we studied in this place for 7 years. So we are returning to the place
to
where we just grew. This is our
youth.
First alma mater. And this was really a school that marked several generations. It was an incredible school. And we miss this.
And we are very proud of it.
And he was a very good basketball player, okay. Besides. Okay, never mind.
Let's get back to international affairs.
I'm sorry, I was just carried away by private musings. But Anand, tell me one thing. You were talking about the several possible features of NATO, or what a French author would call the futurible, the possible futures. Okay, one possible future is for NATO to enlarge itself so much that becomes a global security organization. Is this a foreseeable future?
Well, it has potential, and there are several member states who would like to see NATO be more active out of area and across the globe. The problem comes from the fact that there are other member states who equally strongly oppose this. I mean, some of those states that feel there is still some kind of threat to their territory, and the states to the east of Europe still believe this, want to see NATO focus very much on what they see as its primary task, which is the defense of their territories.
Although one of the states that you mentioned, I guess, could be Russia. And Russia has been forging informal and formal links or semi-links with NATO for long.
Absolutely, though what is striking is firstly that every attempt to institutionalize those relationships has tended to end in failure.
Right.
And two, if you go to the eastern part of Europe, if you go to the Baltic states, or even if you talk to some people in Poland, whilst publicly they're quite polite about Russia,
yeah,
in private they will say, yes, but we need to have a reinsurance policy because we never know.
Yeah, but you all made the point, and I think it's a good one, which is, in a sense, the Syria crisis bridged the gap between Europe, the United States, and Russia. I mean, we can see it from several ways. We could say, okay, the United States said something, and then it went back, and then Russia took the place. But maybe we could see it from another perspective, which is everyone condemns the same phenomenon, the proliferation thing, and maybe Russia, NATO, and Europe could work together.
I think we should and could work more together. We're working together on Iran, for instance, where Cathy Ashton, my most direct boss, chairs the negotiations on behalf of the international community, which
right,
includes the United States, Europe, and Russia, apart from China. So, and I think if you look at all the problems of the world today, and maybe the world is a more complex one and more difficult one to govern than in the times of the Cold War, We need all the actors, in particular those who are in the Security Council of the United Nations. We have been calling for a strong role for the United Nations, even in this particular conflict of Syria. The issue about military intervention without NATO, without the United Nations cover, is a big one for our public opinion. So the closer we get Russia to the positions that we support, the better. This being said, we should be very firm about our principles. We don't want any solution that will sort of delay the problem, that would weaken the pressure on President Assad. So there are a number of principles and conditions that should be applied. But whatever can be done to bring Russia to a more cooperative stance in approving a strong and solid resolution in the Security Council goes in the right direction.
I have a bit of a problem with that. Let me just interrupt, because although I see your point, in reality what's happened with Syria, to me, as an outsider, has caused a huge split between Washington and Europe. President Obama is very forceful about wanting a military strike. Nobody in Europe, with the exception of the French, said yes. And then the French went back and said, well, wait a second, we'll wait for the report from the United Nations. While the American administration is still talking about a military strike, with the Russians saying, well, if you talk about a military strike, this disarmament is not going to happen. So I don't see this harmony. What I see is total division between Washington
I will not, as an ambassador to the United States, I will not comment on the position of the United States as such, but there's a lot to be said about the evolution of the president's position as regards Syria.
But specifically as far as the military strike is concerned, nobody seems to want to do that except him.
Yeah, but even him has changed his position on the military strike.
He's delayed.
Well, I think more accurate is to say even those people who want to, and I think at a certain moment the British, the French and the Americans wanted to, haven't been able to because of domestic pressure.
Precisely.
And I think we should be proud that a parliament like the British Parliament discussed it so openly and so in such
and
a complexity. Independently if it said no or yes, I mean, one of the things the MPs said is that we need more information on this, and we are still not well informed on what is happening. Don't you think that the question of Iraq and the so-called WMD that were not found in Iraq plays a role here?
I think it absolutely plays a role, and I think one of the problems of international politics is everyone tries to reason by analogy, and quite often their analogies are wrong. I'm not sure there's an analogy between Syria and Iraq, but MPs got hold of it. And bear in mind, the British parliamentary vote, I think there were only 48 or 49 MPs.
There were 13 MPs who made a difference.
But there were only about 48 or 49 MPs who voted against both motions. So only 48 or 49 MPs who were opposed to military action in any way, shape or form.
But if you see even the ones that supported military action, the nuances of doubt were so big. Everyone said, we don't want another Iraq. I know about analogy, but we have to compare with something, either the past or the future. Analogy is the past.
And they say we always prepare for the last war. My problem with the British parliamentary vote was there could have been a resolution except for politics. I think there was a lot of political game.
There can still be another vote.
The problem here is that, like for the economic crisis, we are always fighting the previous war. And it's very difficult to engage in a new situation without forgetting the past one. And this applies to foreign policy as much as to the economy.
You represent the European Union in Washington, right? What do you tell the Americans when they say we need a military strike? Which one of the countries you represent will come with us? What do you tell them?
Well, I tell them, first of all, there is no military solution for the Syrian problem. We need to end
up. So no military strike.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying there is no military solution for the problem. There's only a political solution for the problem. At the end of the day, there must be an understanding about the transition. We want President Assad to leave. We want to create the basis for a transition to democracy in Syria, which encompasses all the communities that contributes to the stability in the region. We know all that, and the Americans agree with us. We are on the same wavelength about the need for a final political solution. That's why we supported the Geneva process that Kerry and Lavrov started. So we are in agreement on that. We also agree that Assad using chemical weapons must have a reaction from the international community, and a strong one. And the strongest possible, and the strongest possible reaction is one supported by the United Nations, based on the report of the inspectors. This is the best way for the international community to send a very strong message to President Sadat, but also to many others that may have chemical weapons, may be tempted to use them, and we don't want to use them.
I don't know if you two guys saw the op-ed piece of Vladimir Putin in New York Times. One thing that Putin says is, we know that there was nerve gas used massively, but we think it's the rebels. And then after he says, so we have this plan, which is to dismantle the official arsenal. Does it make sense? So if it's the rebels, what sense does it make to dismantle the official one?
I'm not sure much of the official debate about Syria makes sense, whether it's about what strikes are for, what they will accomplish, who did what. But it does seem to me that the Russians have played the West rather well over Syria.
Did it surprise you that NATO didn't follow President Obama's lead as far as a military strike is concerned?
NATO, no, because there are too many divergent opinions in NATO.
They did in Libya.
Yeah, but even in Libya, there was a very patchy attendance in terms of which NATO allies decided to actually act.
I think that was because they could afford it. Some countries could afford it, others didn't have the money for it.
Partly. I mean, one argument says no one can afford it now. I mean, from an American perspective, I'd say one of the most frightening things is how little Europeans can do by themselves militarily now.
How did you see this return of Vladimir Putin calling for democracy, more democracy in the United States?
Well, I've been dealing with the Russian, and I attended more than 15 summits with Vladimir Putin when I was working for President Barroso, and I think I know the political character relatively well, so nothing surprises me about his moves in this particular crisis. I think we need to be realistic and be pragmatic. If there are signs that Russia wants to play the UN card, we should call their bluff. We should put maximum pressure on Russia to assume its responsibilities as a permanent member of the Security Council, as a major player in the Syrian crisis, and we should move them towards that. And that's where I see, Martin, pragmatic convergence. I'm not sure we share the motivation that maybe leads the Russian to do this, or the calculations, but again, I need to be pragmatic. I need to have something, to see something happen that corresponds to what we believe is necessary. Stop the use of chemical weapons, condemn them in the strongest possible way, prevent them from being used again, and create the conditions for a political solution.
And do you think that President Putin has the leverage with Assad to actually make him do those concrete steps that you're talking about?
I think we all agree.
Identify the weapons, get inspectors in there, and eventually destroy them.
I think we all agree that Russia is a major player in Syria and a major player in the region. And again, we need to put maximum pressure on them to go in that direction. And if it works, so much the better. If it doesn't work, we need to confront them with their responsibilities.
And then returning to analogies, do you see a parallel between what can happen in the so-called disarmament of Syrian chemical weapons with what happened in Libya in 2003 to 2005. 2003, as you know, Libya also declared, okay, we have these weapons, and for 2 years there was a painful process of disarmament where we found certain things that they had that they didn't declare, other things they declared and they had in different quantities. Do you see a process now also like 2 years where Syria is going to be disarmed chemically?
I see very few similarities. Colonel Gaddafi then, lest we forget,
there was not the war,
was about to become
war.
Our friend. He was someone we were not only
he was a good
willing,
guy. He became
willing
a good
to
guy.
Deal with, he was someone we were happy to deal with. I mean, he took his tent around Europe on a tour and parked it wherever he wanted. And that's the big difference with Syria. We don't want Assad in power. So we're dealing with someone we're also trying to oust, which makes it more problematic.
And there is a civil war.
And there's a civil war. So the practicalities of ensuring disarmament seem to me to be rather scary. How do you ensure in a state of war that a country disarms? I don't know how we do that. But I think, if we can make progress through a diplomatic channel, that is preferable to war, because it was equally unclear to me what we were going to bomb and why. I mean, there aren't any easy options here.
And that's part of the debate in the US. since President announced his position, and even before, and certainly after, there has been a very intense debate, and it's not sure that the President will have the votes in the Congress to go there, exactly because the situation is so complex, very different from Libya, as you were saying. I don't think there's a similarity between Syria and any other case. So it makes it particularly complex and difficult.
Especially because...
One point on what you were saying about... we will not support any delaying tactics from the Russian side or from the Syrian side about the present discussion on...
Define delaying.
Yeah.
Define delaying.
Well, I think the delay has to be defined against the background of the seriousness of the violation.
But you cannot have delays if you don't have a calendar. If there is no calendar,
well, we're talking about that. That's part of the discussion. But on our side, you will see Europe putting a lot of pressure on Russia, on Syria, and I think the U.S. as well, in order for this to be a swift process. Otherwise, we need to return to other options and reopen the debate, that will be a more difficult one.
Just quickly, we have to put that pressure on, because the other danger for the West, it seems to me, is that what support there is for military action will dissipate over time. We portray this as something crucial that we had to act on now. Even in France, the more time goes by, the harder it will be for President Hollande to get the necessary, well, he doesn't need a vote in the National Assembly, but it would be embarrassing if large numbers came out against him. And the same in Washington.
I was going to ask your opinion on that. The successive delays that President Obama has made to a military attack, now saying he asked Congress to delay the vote on top of all, which, as you say, there's no guarantee that he would have won. Doesn't this effectively mean, in your opinion, that President Obama won't attack militarily Syria?
I think the starting point has to be, the president
he's painted himself into a corner, hasn't he?
The president was elected to end two wars, to start the third one.
And he's a Nobel Peace Prize winner.
Someone called him, David Ignatius, a reluctant warrior.
Yes. Yes.
We know that he's not favorable to intervention.
It's
not in his nature. But he was very clear and very courageous, I think, in stating his own position and saying, I think that the military strike should take place. Then the other developments took place. But there's an intense debate in Europe, as much as there is in the U.S., as much as there is in Europe. You mentioned the case of the House of Commons. There's a more and more intense debate in France and in all our countries. In this conference here in our school, we've been discussing, is Europe becoming isolationist? How is Europe dealing with the outside world? So our public opinions don't want war. They don't think that military action is necessarily the best option. But politicians have to be responsible. And in this particular case, if we allow the use of chemical weapons, like in the Syrian case, to be something normal, what message are we sending to other parts of the world? People that don't respect our values, that may be equipped with these kind of weapons, they will feel free to do it. So it's a very difficult one.
Let me just return for a moment to you. You're a specialist, and you've been writing about the state of the European Union, how it was built, how is it currently, what's going to be the project. We had President Durão Barroso talking about the state of the Union, and some British members of Parliament were not so comfortable about certain remarks he made about the role of Britain. Were those remarks justified and just?
Well, they were probably correct. Whether he was justified in making them is a slightly different issue.
You don't think he was a good politician by saying it?
Well, in general, my understanding is that politicians come up with a line which is, I don't comment on the domestic politics of other states.
Right.
And I think it might have been slightly easier had he done so now, because it just makes life a little bit harder for pro-Europeans at home if people from outside Britain say things like that.
It just shows you how frustrated Barroso is.
No, I share his frustration. I think the debate in Britain is potty.
I think, if I may, a very good point that you made, and a very interesting case. I think what President Barroso wanted to say very clearly, and I think it's part of his State of the Union speech, is a call for the pro-Europeans to be extremely attentive to what is at stake in this electoral year. We know we have elections for the European Parliament in next May. And there is a rise in populism in Europe. largely fueled by the crisis, and that those who are pro-Europe, and I am of course pro-Europe, need to be very attentive to this. And I think there are pro-Europeans in Britain, including the Prime Minister and his party, and the debate in Strasbourg was about what should the pro-Europeans do? Should their discourse be one that makes them quite close to the Eurosceptics, to the point of, in fact, supporting supporting the rise of the Eurosceptics? And the President was saying, I mean, the copy is never as good as the original. So there has to be a clearer distinction between the pro-European discourse and the Eurosceptic discourse.
But even President Barroso, which we know from long time ago, also said, he didn't say these words I'm going to say, but he said no more blank checks. I mean, we have to see exactly what Europe is doing. We have to analyze policy by policy. We cannot just say I'm pro-European, just accept everything what is done in the name of Europe.
I agree. Right? One of the problems with the debates on Europe, particularly in Britain, is that you're either for or against. There is no nuance. There's no... I think European integration is a good idea. I'm not convinced the euro was a great idea, but most of what the EU does, I'm in favour of. But you can't be nuanced in our debate. You either want to stay in and take everything, or you want to leave. And I think what the frustration about what President Barroso said at home is that he was absolutely right, that the Conservatives are mimicking UKIP positions on the EU. But it makes the moderate pro-European position harder to defend if you're being attacked from abroad. And I think that's the frustration.
Yeah, the Europe is a whole, right? I mean, it's difficult to consider that the President of the European Commission or the President of the European Council are foreigners, in the sense that they represent also Britain when they talk to the outside. I also represent partly Britain when I discuss with the U.S.
They are distant cousins.
And
oldest allies.
Barroso is not a foreigner to any country in Europe in that matter.
Yeah. In that sense, yes, but it's a national election.
I think, right. Yes, it is. I think that's a great idea. I think that if the British press picks that up, it'll be great. We're running out of time. It's been a very interesting conversation.
Thank you both.
Thank you.
For being with us this week here in your old Liceu in Lisbon.
Yeah, thank very you. Proud of it. Very
thank
proud
you
of
very
it.
Much.
Most proud.
Both of you. Thank you. E vamos então à segunda parte do programa desta semana. Continuamos aqui na Biblioteca do Liceu Pedro Nunes, onde tu, eu estou-te a ver, jovem, aqui a amarrar milhões
calções,
de livros à tua volta. Exatamente,
sempre
só livros
no quadro
a consultar.
Tive 7 anos no quadro de honra, imagino.
Por favor.
Era muito chato.
E lias muito aqui.
Lia muito aqui, é verdade. Mas também trazia muitos livros de casa, mas lia muito aqui. Jogava agora... futebol, Berlim.
E agora tens uns livros que não são daqui.
Agora despertamos para a crua realidade, como governar um país, de Marco Túlio Cícero, um grande pensador romano, 100 anos antes de Cristo.
Portanto, não muito contemporâneo.
Não muito contemporâneo, mas os pensamentos são muito contemporâneos. Ele foi um grande advogado, um grande orador, talvez um dos grandes oradores da Antiguidade, e aquilo que escreveu sobre como governar os assuntos públicos, desde a economia, como fazer finanças equilibradas, como governar em paz e como governar em guerra, como assegurar que os governantes não são corruptos, como...
Leitura obrigatória para os políticos.
Leitura obrigatória, sobretudo, olha, um livro tão importante, mas com pensamentos tão condensados que tem este tamanho.
É pequenino. Hã?
Como governar um país, Marco Túlio Cícero, demora pouco tempo a ler, mas demora bastante tempo a aprender.
E mais?
E depois trago-te Perceptions, Journal of International Affairs, é o novo número. É uma espécie de foreign policy, ou de foreign affairs, se quisermos, um boletim de estudos internacionais, publicado por quem? Pelos turcos, por um Instituto de Relações Internacionais turco, muito ligado...
Em inglês,
muito ligado ao Ministério dos Negócios Estrangeiros turco. E é curioso, estamos aqui com o nosso convidado, com o Anan Menon, e uma das coisas que ele disse, estava aqui a ver, e disse, mas isto é só sobre a Ásia, isto é só sobre a Ásia Central. Se perceberes bem qual é hoje a grande preocupação dos turcos, é sobretudo a Ásia Central. Já não é tanto a nossa Europa, mas a Ásia Central. Perception, Journal of International Affairs, pode ser encontrado depois no nosso site, podemos lá pôr uma indicação de como é que se pede isto. Perception. E por fim, Prémio Nobel da Literatura, que já morreu há bastante tempo, morreu nos anos 60, William Faulkner. Mosquitos, um dos grandes livros, arrisco-me a dizer, do século XX, uma escrita muito clara e, sobretudo, o Faulkner tinha uma coisa, conseguia traduzir os diálogos que nós temos, portanto, a chamada linguagem verbal, muito bem escrita. Porque uma das coisas que acontece, não sei se reparas nisso, é que quando se quer passar do oral para o escrito, aquilo resulta um bocadinho artificial.
Às vezes.
Às vezes. O Faulkner era espantoso nisso. Mosquito William Faulkner, Prémio Nobel de Literatura, para quem ainda tem férias, uma boa leitura de férias. E a música? É uma surpresa, eu não a conhecia. Este homem, jovem, este homem chama-se Marco Rodrigues, é um homem que pega no fado, mas depois transforma o fado numa série de outras coisas, música árabe, música étnica, jazz, e traz aqui uma canção muito bonita chamada Rosa e o Narciso, que é da Luísa Sobral, que também é uma grande cantora e também poetisa portuguesa, que é sobre um amor impossível. Uma mulher totalmente organizada e um homem totalmente desorganizado. Um homem que anda com um sapato de uma cor e um sapato de outro que não faz a barba. Ela é toda organizadinha, tem os livros todos impecáveis. No entanto, é um grande amor.
Marco Rodrigues.
Marco Rodrigues, a Rosa e o Narciso.
E chegamos assim ao fim desta edição especial aqui da Biblioteca do Liceu Pedro Nunes, em Lisboa, com a música portuguesa, ou talvez não.
Música do mundo de um grande talento, um grande novo talento português.
E já sabe, se quiser rever este programa ou rever estas sugestões aqui do Nuno, pode fazê-lo em www.sicnoticias.sap.pt e pode também escrever-nos sdn@sic.pt. Voltaremos para a semana que vem. E acorda mesmo sem o despertador tocar. Ninguém sabe como este amor nasceu entre uma rosa e a lua no céu. Como a rosa ao ver a lua sorrir se deu. Mas ninguém duvida deste grande amor, até quem inveja o seu fulgor, é que afinal também ele tem nome de flor, Narciso. Às vezes ele quer dormir no chão, diz que a coluna prende a posição. Este programa é patrocinado por Staples. Este programa é patrocinado por Chiado Editora.
Rui Santos pergunta, no seguimento das declarações de Nuno Lobo, quem vai liderar o futebol português nos próximos anos?
Entregue 10 tinteiros HP vazios e poupe 20€ na compra de 5 tinteiros HP novos. Multivantagens Staples. Ganham todos, até o ambiente. Staples é tão fácil.
O vento é capaz de chegar aos 400 km por hora. A sua energia transforma montanhas, mas não é capaz disto.
Hã?
Sobe, desce, devagar.
Peço que estrague.
Viu? Como?
A maior energia é a sua.
EDP, viva a sua energia.
Esta semana no Expresso, saiba tudo sobre os bastidores e o futuro da fusão PT-Oi.
Percebo como as ondas de choque das autárquicas estão a afetar o governo e como Pedro Passos Coelho e Cavaco Silva apostam tudo na saída da Troika na primavera de 2014. Expresso, há 40 anos a fazer opinião.
No 17º aniversário da Vorten, ter preços de arromba é ter tudo a 1 euro por dia.
Ou seja, pague 30 euros por mês em compras entre os 30 euros e os 900 euros com acerto na última mensalidade. TAEG 0%. Para comprar tudo o que precisa.
Porque o nosso forte é o preço. Vorten sempre.
O Courrier, com o apoio da Staples Corporate, apresentam toda a informação num só espaço. Já nas bancas. Agora também disponível na versão tablet. Veja as condições de adesão em assinja.pt. Correia Internacional. Em síntese, tudo.
Só Rexona tem Motion Sense, que é ativado sempre que te moves. Quanto mais te moves, mais protegido ficas. Faz mais, sem te preocupares com a transpiração. Rexona nunca falha.
Entregue 10 tinteiros HP vazios e poupe 20 euros na compra de 5 tinteiros HP novos. Multivantagens Staples. Ganham todos, até o ambiente. Staples é tão fácil.
Gama Jaguar XF. Desde 51.341 euros.
Isto é Matemática. Recebeu o troféu Homenagem Especial Ver Ciência 2013. Pela forma como despertou o interesse do público para a importância da matemática no nosso dia-a-dia. Um prémio já atribuído à BBC, Sir David Attenborough ou TV Globo News Ciência e Tecnologia. Agora, em vez do programa da SIC Notícias.
Isto é matemática. Agora,